spiritual humility, who would be the companion of the wise and know the cosmic splendor, he must stoop. Who seeks to stand, must fall who fain would rise. Must know the low, ascending to the high. He who would know the great must not disdain to diligently wait upon the small. He wisdom finds who finds humility. Through the sacred scriptures of all religions there runs, like a silver thread, the teachings of humility. Not only all the scriptures, but the sages of all time, have declared that only through the portal of humility is it possible for man to enter into the possession of the life of truth. And as that life is entirely of a spiritual nature, so the humility that leads to it is purely and absolutely spiritual, and being such, it can never be materialized. It can never be embodied in a dogma or laid down as a formula. It is not an outward thing, nor does it consist of that practice of self-abasement that has usurped its name. But priests have taught, and many have been led to believe, that self-deprecation is true humility, while in reality, it is extreme antithesis. Self-deprecation is self-degradation. It is even a sort of self-destruction. It is spiritual suicide. The man who believes that all his righteousness is as filthy rags, that there is no good thing in him, and that he can never rise by any effort of his own, is by that very attitude of his mind rendering himself impotent. He is strangling the spirit. He is undermining and disintegrating all that is highest and noblest in his character. Instead of building up his character, he is engaged in despoiling it. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. What our thoughts are, such are our characters. We are in reality beings composed of thoughts. Thoughts are the bricks which we are continually laying down in the building of our souls. If we put a large percentage of rotten bricks into a building, we shall build but a miserable hovel, and every self-deprecating thought is a brick that is already crumbling. It will be found to be a rule, marvelously accurate in its application, that those who continually live in this attitude of self-deprecation are throughout life, or at any rate, until they strike a nobler attitude, wretched failures. I can bring to my mind many such men that I have known. How can it be otherwise? How can a man who has no faith in himself ever win the confidence of others, or accomplish anything worthy? Moreover, such a man has not, cannot possibly have, any faith in human nature. Despising himself, he despises all, and as a result, by the unerring law of cause and effect, all men despise him. Yet it is a strange fact that the men who maintain this faith-destroying attitude of mind invariably profess to have the greatest faith in God, look upon it as an infallible witness to their superior spiritual faith. But I ask this question: does not true faith, like true charity, begin at home? In the growth of the soul, faith in oneself comes first, next faith in human race, and finally faith in God. That faith which professes to have the latter to the exclusion of the two former is false faith. The outcome is fake humility. Another kind of false humility is that of personal abasement to an individual or to an established authority. This is humility materialized or subverted. It is the worship of the Dagon, the bowing of the knee to Baal, the slavish adoration of the golden calf. No man can persist in it without undermining his character and ultimately dissipating his spiritual and mental energies. Humility to man or to any temporal authority is degrading and slavish. Humility to the Most High is grandly beautiful. Spiritual humility is closely allied to faith, and the more there is of humility, the more there is of faith. It is the keynote of all real goodness. In proof of this, I have only to refer to the great sages, saints, and reformers of all time. The greatest of them are those who had the greatest share of spiritual humility. True humility, as distinguished from false, has a strengthening power, an upbuilding force. It inspires and invigorates the soul, spurring it to greater and ever greater endeavor. Of what, then, does this humility consist? Is it the bending of the knee to ask personal favors of the deity? Is it the blind petitioning of God to accomplish for us our petty and narrow designs? Nay, these are its counterfeits. True humility is far above and beyond all this. It is the deepest and holiest aspiration of the human heart, where deep within, hidden from all sacrilegious gaze, it works, a silent mighty power, purifying, transforming, the man of flesh and self, entering its solitary grandeur, the alienated soul returns to the footstool of its God and bathes in blissful rapture in the light of his all-embracing love. It is a state that can only be entered into by rising above one's lower self. It is, in fact, the submergence of the self in the non-self, the submission of passion and intellect to the Supreme. It is the attitude of a human soul adoring its highest conception. Such humility takes its possessor above all that is mean and poor in his nature, into the very presence of God, making him calm, strong, noble, self-reliant, and godlike. It is the wine of life to all aspiring souls. The soul that has not felt its power is dead. It may sound like a paradox, but is nevertheless true, that the more a man has of humility, the more he has of independence. But the seeming paradox will be made clear if we think for a moment of the lives of such teachers of humility as Jesus, Buddha, Confucius, Socrates, Jacob Burma, George Fox, and indeed all the great religious reformers. These men walked erect because, yielding themselves up to the simplicity of humility, they walked with God. The humility that causes a man to go, metaphorically speaking, on all fours is spurious and is as debasing and destructive as the real humility is elevating and strengthening. Why should we go amongst our fellows like cringing, fearful beasts, calling ourselves miserable sinners? Shall we ever rise above sin by so doing? Is it possible to rise by ceaselessly contemplating our absolute unworthiness? No, we can only rise by continually contemplating the highest. There may be much that is unworthy in a man's heart, but there is also a sacredness, a dignity, a divinity about it. Let us dwell upon that. Let us continually contemplate the goodness, the purity, and the essential beauty of human nature. Let us ceaselessly search for the divinity in our own souls, and finding it through the door of humility, we shall then recognize the invisible God in all men. By so doing, we rise above the binding limitations of our selfish desires and enter the larger, healthier, holier life of love. End of chapter 9. Recording by Andrea Fiore.